Hi everyone, welcome. It is my pleasure to welcome you to the St. Louis Art Museum, and I want to begin by acknowledging that the St. Louis region is the ancestral territory for a lineage of indigenous peoples, including the Mississippian civilization, Osage Nation, and members of the Illini Confederacy, including the Peoria tribe of Oklahoma. And today, a diversity of Native peoples live and work in St. Louis. It is really an honor to welcome and introduce Faye HeavyShield to the SLAM stage. Among the leading First Nations artists in Canada, HeavyShield belongs to the Kainai Nation, a member of the Niitsitapi, or Blackfoot Confederacy, with ancestral territories in southern Alberta. She studied at the Alberta College of Art and Design and the University of Calgary. Since the 1980s, HeavyShield has created sculpture, installations, and performances. She uses minimal form and humble materials to draw her personal experience, cultural knowledge, and relationship to the land into her work. HeavyShield has exhibited widely across North America, including the landmark 1992 exhibition, Land, Spirit, Power, at the National Gallery of Canada, the 2009 Eideljort Fellowship, and the 2019 exhibition, Hearts of Our People. Last week, her exhibition, The Art of Faye HeavyShield, opened at the Winnipeg Art Gallery, and earlier this spring, her exhibition, Faye HeavyShield Confluences, opened here at the Pulitzer Arts Foundation, and here in St. Louis at the Pulitzer Arts Foundation. And I want to be sure to mention that tomorrow morning, Faye will be in conversation with Anita Fields at the Pulitzer Arts Foundation, who's one of the artists in Counter Public now showing around St. Louis. And I also want to acknowledge Tamara, who curated Faye's exhibition at the Pulitzer, and Risa Puglio, who curated Anita's work at Counter Public. So we're thrilled that you can join us this evening. Thanks for being here. I also want to mention that as the recipient of the 2021 Gershon Iskowitz Prize, Faye HeavyShield will show next year at the Art Gallery of Ontario in Toronto. So she has a very full plate these days, and we're honored that her commitments include the St. Louis Art Museum. Thank you. So today we are thrilled to open a collaborative installation with HeavyShield in the Danforth Gallery for Plains Art. If you have not already seen this installation, I encourage you after the talk to walk over to the third floor of the museum. This is the most recent iteration of a series where artists relate historic works from the collection to contemporary Indigenous ways of seeing. Faye is an artist who I've long admired and who brings significant experience working with museum collections, including at the Glenbow and the Royal Ontario Museum. So I began to think about her for this project in 2021 in conversation with Tamara and the Pulitzer. And then during a visit to St. Louis in 2022, HeavyShield initiated a conversation here with her relatives, the three parflish by Niitsitapi artists in the museum collection. It has been a privilege to work with Faye to realize her vision in the gallery. So please join me in welcoming Faye HeavyShield.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that, Alex. Okay, everyone, greetings. I'll start by saying thank you for the city, this land, everyone that I've met. This is my third visit here, and it's your generosity and your hospitality is really overwhelming, and so I keep coming back. also want to thank Tamara and Anita. It was such a thrill yesterday to see your installation. It's just thrilling. Cara, John, for the tour of Cahokia, and my new friend, Kellen. So there's so many people here that that's what makes a community. And I'm really thankful to you all for including me in this community. So I'll start by I always like to say my father's name, Akohkitopi, and my mother's name is Sitaki, Eddie and Adelaide HeavyShield. I speak the Blackfoot language as my first language. I learned English before I started school, but after that it was, you know, spoken all the time in the school. So I think we'll just start with some images here. This is not really in any sort of order, but to, I guess, give you an idea of the influences on my work, the materials that I use, I guess in some way to relay that that respect I have for material and for where art comes from, because I'm not a magician. I don't make things up. I don't feel that way. I feel that I feel very fortunate that it has been a blessing that somehow I'm hearing and remembering things that my ancestors spoke, felt, dreamed. And so I'm really fortunate in that sense that that I'm able to be a conduit for that living history. Because, you know, as well, most artists, indigenous artists, know that indigeneity, indigenous people, they didn't, I guess, stop existing just when that history book was closed. And that's really something that I feel it so strongly here, especially with Counter Public. And you're welcome to me here at the museum. People also like Helen Kornblum. It's such a vital feeling of being in a place that recognizes that art is very much alive. Niitsitapi have always been here and not going anywhere. So on to this is an image of the piece called The Red Line. So I use different materials in my process. How it started was that when I attended the art college, I just went into it cold, pretty much. It wasn't something that I aspired to. It was more or less finding a place that I fit. I didn't really fit anywhere else. And if you can imagine, I even tried enrolling in a computer programming course. And sitting in there for even the first month, I thought they were speaking, well, they were speaking another language. And, and I never understood it. And I got tired of just kind of nodding and pretending that I understood. So after the first semester, I knew I wasn't meant to be there. So it was more a process of not going in that direction, but going in different directions and finding out that wasn't for me. So I ended up at the art college, and even in my first, I would say, year or so at the art college, there was still a sense of, like, I really enjoyed being in the studio, but I was still just maybe like a baby trying to walk or just to negotiate the space there. One thing I did find was that of the art history courses that were expected of us, I didn't see anything that I could reference as something I belong to. And the images that were from Indigenous people or people from cultures outside of a Eurocentric culture, they were deemed primitive, and it was, I guess I saw it as not being validated until someone like Picasso, you know, put his name on it and signed it. So I didn't really attend a lot of art history courses, but that was good for me because I ended up having to find a language and develop a vocabulary that I could work with. And that came from references that I knew. It came from references like the land, my family, the language, my culture in general, and myself, and using my body also as a reference. And so that's how I started to develop my own vocabulary for my art practice. I soon found that I liked the comfort of working in a repetitive, or I guess with multiples. And in one way, it did come from one of the instructors at the art college who advised that instead of working on one drawing and just putting all your blood, sweat, whatever into that, and in that way thinking of it as precious, why not make 10 drawings, start 10 drawings, and that way you can try different things and you can make mistakes, if you know that's what you call them, but also it opened up so many other perspectives, and even as simply as flipping that page around and working at it from a different place. To me, that really related to where I live out on southern Alberta, the prairies leading into the foothills. It's such a wide open place that you just breathe so easily. And so that method of working, I really became attached to. So this, I think, this is at the Pulitzer, but I think that I added to this, it first showed in Vancouver in 2021. A lot of this work was done during COVID, during isolation. And it's these beads are wrapped around a cord and attached, and it's all the same color, so it's not really any sort of measuring, or there's no method really to it other than it soon became, it wasn't intended, but it soon became, I guess, a comfort in that isolation, because of course, there would be only in my cohort, there would be maybe three others, two of my grandkids and my daughter, that would be coming to the home. And so, of course, there were always also the cats, but so this, it really afforded me that company that I kept as I was beading and thinking about not just memories, but also thinking ahead and thinking about lineage. And so it's almost as though these beads, or each length of, you know, a little bit of the beads that were on this cord, it was like a conversation I was having. This is another obsession of mine. I have a library of photos of grasses from where I live. And I think I have probably at least a couple of thousand of these images. And these are used in the same sense that the beads are used with that cord. So this image has shown up in this piece called Wave, where these strips of these are woven around a cord, and then in the end, that cord is in a spiral configuration on the floor. And I love this color. And so even when not using photographic or digital images, I'm always drawn to that really, that color of that pale ochre, because it also brings to my mind age, like bleached bones or, you know, that sort of organic material. I've been invited, as Alex mentioned, I've been invited several times to two museum collections and invited to make work in response to those pieces in the museum. This is a recent one. This is 2 hours east of where I live in a collection in the Medicine Hat Museum and Gallery. And these items are part of a collection known as the Burkitt Collection. And this woman that collected all these items, she did live, I guess, in the community, I think in relation to, well, back then it would be the mission school or, so she was known to the members of the community, and that was her, I guess, how she got these items. And for the most part, items in a museum collection, there's an anonymity. And so maybe it will say Blackfoot. Okay, well, that's a start. But so this is one of the only pieces I've seen where it said HeavyShield. So I knew that this rattle at one point belonged to someone that I was closely related to. And when our conversations here first started, it helped that, you know, the times that we did talk, Alex, that I was able to articulate my feelings about when I am in a space where there's drawers, everything is sterile, and but I know that these items once had a purpose, and it's almost like DNA, that trace, that I know someone, especially this rattle, was somebody from the Heavy Shields, was holding it, they made it. I don't know for what purpose, if it was a ceremony, I don't know the songs that went with it, but it was really important to me when I visited this collection that that these relatives of mine heard the Blackfoot language, and so that it would be, I consider it visiting the old people. So it was important for me that even though I didn't know a song or I didn't know whether it was a ceremony, but I wanted to hold it in my hand and shake it so that its purpose, the purpose of a rattle is to have sound. And so I wanted that to happen. So that's what we did. You know, I didn't sing, but we shook the rattle and we spoke Blackfoot to it, as with most of these pieces. And that's sort of, I guess, my approach to pieces in collections, is that I recognize that there is a life to them still, even though that life is stilled, but it's life all the same. This is my sister, Ikinanchki, Lena. She's the oldest of my siblings. Lena attended, she's 89 now. She attended residential school, as did our parents, everyone else in our family. Lena was, I guess, favored by the people in the residential school. And she is a very intelligent, sharp person. And so they must have recognized that in her, because she was selected out of everyone. She was the first person from our community to attend a teacher's college. So she left the community, she went and she became a teacher. She returned to the community, and the first job that she had was in the small elementary school in the Laverne community, it's called. And she right away saw that there had to be something done to keep our language going. And so on top of all the other classes that were taking place, the math and whatever else, science, this was an elementary school, so they were all young children, but she made sure that the Blackfoot language was being taught, and that they're called Niitsitapi, but that means people that live by the river. But it was later called Laverne after a priest that Father Laverne, he was a longtime member, I guess, of the community. But anyhow, that community to this day has, I think, the strongest hold of language. And I visited there when my daughter was teaching there for a while. And it's not amazing, but it just feels so good that if you go into the kindergarten class and all these little four-year-olds are speaking Blackfoot and they're saying giving a Blackfoot blessing, and they know what they're saying. So that's really something, and you know, it's because of Lena. And she went beyond that. She worked towards having Blackfoot established in the curriculum, not just in our community, in the surrounding schools, off reserve, and Blackfoot is offered at a university level now. So that's, thank you, Ikinanchki. This is, I guess, an example of some of the other materials that I've used. One of the really, I guess, something that really had a powerful influence on me in recent years was a visit to a medicine wheel. And the English name would be like the Majorville, but because it's located on private land now, not from our community, but we still are able to visit. So this visit that we took, at the time I was still working with children's services and working with children and youth from our community who were placed in foster care. So they're now removed from the community, from their family. And so as a program at Children's Services, We developed activities so that we would go and visit these children and come up with different activities just for them to stay connected with the community, even though they're not no longer with their families. So one of those visits to the medicine wheel, one of the youth that came along was living in a group home. So we had a guide to take us to this site, and we went through all, you know, the protocol of leaving offerings. And when he started to speak of that place, I was just astounded, because one of the stories that my grandmother, Sami Chikana, and Sami Chikana, you'll see her name etched on that Black Sea downstairs. Sami Chikana was Kate Three Persons, my paternal grandmother, and when I was a child, she told stories to us, and those stories were so, they just were so engaging that as a child, I would feel that that I was part of that story, that I could sense, you know, what these characters in the story were feeling. One of the stories was of this woman that fell in love with Morning Star, and she eventually did become taken into the sky to be Morning Star's wife. And while she was up there, she grew homesick. She grew homesick, very homesick. And because the sun would be away during the day, she was left alone, so even more homesick. But one of the conditions she was given, she could do whatever she wanted, but there was a wild turnip plant, and she was told, you can never touch that, you never pull it. But of course, you know, you're told you can't do something, you're going to do it. So she did, and the hole that it left, she could see her camp on Earth. And instead of being reprimanded or punished for doing that, the sun and moon took pity on her, and they said, you can go home, but you'll be given this gift of the sun dance. And the way my grandmother told it was that how she came back down to Earth, how I pictured it, and I don't, it was like a filament, like a spider web filament, and that's how she returned to Earth. And so getting back to the site visit for the medicine wheel, what our guide, our elder, told us was that was the site where she came back to Earth. And so I was just, you know, the ground shook really for me, knowing that I knew that those stories had to come from a real place, but I didn't know, you know, that it was actually made physical for me, that I could actually be in that place. And not that I ever thought that these stories were made up. I knew there was a time when rocks could talk, when animals could talk. There was a time in our history, in our beliefs, that that's what takes place. And so that was the effect that that visit had on me. So a later work that I did, I always remembered that center cache of stones, and there's a wide ring of stones, but there's also these spokes of, I think I'll use this toy here. I was told I could use this. So there's these spokes that radiate from the center, and what they were finding later was that it was like an astral map that our people used certain times of the year and those spokes to indicate, you know, where the stars were. And so they had that knowledge of, it wasn't just us on Earth. So this image was done with Okanoki, Saskatoon berries. And Saskatoon berries, they're all over southern Alberta. They're also used not just as a really tasty dish, but also used a lot in ceremony at the Sundance. And so anytime, maybe if there's not just at the Sundance, but say if there's going to be a naming ceremony, that's one of the things that, you know, people will bring. So this project was for, I think it was from magazine artist page. And so what ended up, there was a couple of different things that took place. So that's that collage of the grasses and then the berries. And then I took another piece of wood just to press it on there. So that was inspired by the medicine wheel. Getting hungry for Okanoki now. Another, I guess, aspect of my practice has at times included performance, audio. This is part of an installation called Clan, and this was in 2018 or 19. And there are these tiny flags here. These are the same fabric as the dresses that I made. And this was inspired by my grandmother, again, Sami Chikana. And I had seen a studio portrait of her in the Glenbow archives. It wasn't in our family. But she was wearing a white dress. It was a black and white portrait. And she held a baby in her arms, but my baby was not anybody from our family. So I used that as a starting point, and I wanted her to meet her great-granddaughter and her great-granddaughters and her great-great-granddaughters through this art. So one of the, this part of it was the performance that was documented and the video later shown as part of the gallery piece. But those little flags, we went to this area, and those are two of my daughters and two granddaughters. And we had these flags, or they had the flags, and they went, and before it happened, they spoke to the old people that lived there, and just to reassure them that we're not here to disturb, we're asking for your blessing, and we want to be respectful. So each one of them kept placing these flags in the ground. And when we were done, we took those flags and they were later placed in the gallery as another piece. This was a really cold day. This is late October, and but that's a benefit of working with your family. They don't have a choice if you tell them to do something, especially if it's your children or your grandchildren. Another series I've been working on for some time now, it's called To the East. So the house I'm living in is the house that my grandmother and her husband had built. And this is the view that you see when you step outside the door and look east. These are mokwansis, meaning the belly buttes. And so that's something that's always just sort of fallen into place as I work on a piece, is that there's now, it's very natural for me to think, how is this in relation to, there's not really any distinction now between body and land. And this is really affirmed by stories about the land. And so this one version is that Katui is a hero in one of those stories. When his stomach opened, this is what came up from the land. So this is Katuyis or the land's belly. And so this, I was taking pictures of these sometimes, a couple of times a day, a couple of times a week. And when I first started looking, started out the series, I was thinking that very distinct horizon, if I see it enough, and if I take images recorded, will it be imprinted? If I never had to see it again, would I have it imprinted? But then it just flipped on me, which is something that happens as I'm working. Sometimes the material will tell me this is something else, you know. So when I started out thinking about sameness, what I ended up finding out was it's about difference, because each time, even though it would maybe be 2 hours later, because of the light, that time of day, it would be a different thing. So that really made concrete for me that absence and presence, constant and change could exist, that they do coexist. You can tell I have spent a lot of time by myself thinking these things. So Mukwan ceased again, and whoops. I have quite a few of these. And every year, Kaena has had akukatsin. And akukatsin is another of the terms that you'll see etched on that piece in the gallery. Akukatsin means that gathering, the sun dance. And this has been taking place forever. And so this happens every summer. And it's a place of, it's a time of spiritual renewal. So this is where the societies in the community, they have their ceremony, but it's also a place of reunion for families, for the community. So a lot of ceremony takes place here, but also I think our maternal grandfather was an active member, but we were never, but we would still visit. We knew it was there. We would go. We knew family. So you bring food or somebody, you'll go and eat there and just hang out. So it's also a time of, social gathering as well, but mostly about spiritual renewal. These drums, I spoke about working with audio as well. So these drums had an audio element where we worked with, I'm not a tech person at all, but I really know a lot of good people. So we had, my family and I and some friends had our heartbeats recorded. And so this is, you see the drums, but the sound is very faint. And that's another thing that I think has happened often in my art making is that distance and proximity. When you think of those, as sometimes you'll think of them as two different things, but they really work for me in that the closer, like say for instance this, you'll just, when you go into the gallery, it's drums and it's quiet. But as you get closer and the more you kind of engage with the work, then you start to feel, hear the heartbeats. That's the drum. I want to keep an eye on the time. So there we are getting our heartbeats recorded. That's Wave, and that was the piece that had the grasses, and that a lot of the work is site-specific, meaning that depending on how much space you have, this, I think at its first showing, it was 30-foot diameter piece. And then they're quite malleable, so this last piece, this last gallery where we had it, you just make it so that the line is closer together, lines are closer together. My old friends, there's a detail of wave. And so again, the whole process is just something that's, you know, you sit there and you just become absorbed. I become absorbed into, and when that happens enough, then that's when these things that you either say, okay, well, maybe if I do it this way, or you just learn something. So this is an early, this is a study for wave. The activities that we had with children and youth in care, we also addressed the caseworkers and the stakeholders in the caregiver system. We also wanted them to know about these children's culture and how important it was to support that. And it wasn't always by just telling them that, so we would actually have activities. So these were made by caseworkers. This is Ohkotok. So there are many sites in our territory that are significant, and they're explained in those stories. And so one of those stories is about Napi being chased by a rock. I told that story this morning, but I don't know. I don't want to take up too much time. This is body of land. And each of these cones are digital images of skin. So very close up. And I started initially with just my own skin. But then since then, it's been extended to images of my grandchildren, my children, people that I meet sometimes. So those are formed into cones, and I envisioned a community, a landscape. And one of the first times that it was installed, I guess one of those things that the work communicated to me was it was installed in a sort of a long rectangular space. So it was only maybe the last third of the wall and the end wall and then back here. And so when they were all installed and I was standing there, it sounds weird, but it felt like I shrank physically and that I could inhabit that community. So it was really that it just took me in. So this is the series To the East. And that, whoops. From the left is my brother Jordan, Niitsitapi, my brother Stephen Sinno, my mom is Sitaki, my younger sister, Sharon, Kakatu'saki, and that's me in that clown hat. And so that house is where I live now. It's a detail of body of land that was used for that. Shawl project I worked with, they were termed vulnerable youth, and it's, I wanted to show this today because it, you know how they designate one day is this and one day is that. Today is recognizing missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls. And so this project was a shawl project, and there were about 15 girls that I would visit in Edmonton about 5 hours away. So a couple times a month I would go up there, and each one of them had been directly affected by that. And one girl had lost her mom and her auntie. So these shawls were made, and we went through a bit of almost like a ritual. So this was canvas, and before we started, they would before they did anything to the canvas, they would wrap it around themselves and feel the weight of the shawl. And then they started telling their story on the shawls. And the red line. That's my younger brother, John, is gone now. And that girl with the big chiclet teeth is me. And you could tell this is from a time when I had just started residential school, maybe a year or two in. You can tell by the haircut. And that's it. Oh, this is some water images. My favorite. And so this is an installation view of, so this is Samichikana there. My Marley is here right now. That's Marley, her mom, and then my daughter Heidi. These are the flags that were planted in the ground, and those are the dresses that we wore. And again, with the grass, we have a new college in our community, Red Crow College. And so I sent my grass files to my IT person, and in this new, the atrium of this new college, I was told that sometimes they would have a teepee erected there. And so I found out the diameter, it was a 30-foot, I think, teepee. And so I wanted that to be a place where when the teepee was there, that it would, all this grass would be inside. So this is like a laminate or something. And this is my grandson. My friend, the river. And there's Wave again. Again. Thank you.
In here, there's so much that we could talk about, but I think one of the things that really struck me was the seven drums, and I wondered if there was symbolism about how they were laid out, the number seven. I just wanted to ask the heartbeat drums to a little bit more, please.
Well, there are several different connections that can be made and that I do make as I'm making the work, and a lot of times it's not predetermined. So sometimes things will shift. But with the seven is a good number for us because seven is the seven brothers in what you know as the Big Dipper. So that's also that story about them, how they escaped into the sky to make that constellation. So there are different things that come from here and there, and it's not really about a single direction into or a single idea.
Thank you, because you brought to mind some of the beautiful Paul Goebel books and stories as a way to preserve some of the tales that you've mentioned.
Thank you.
Yeah, no, beautiful.
Thank you so much. Again, so many questions one could ask, but may I ask a somewhat slam St. Louis Art Museum specific one. Could you talk a little bit or share a little bit about the process of coming to the installation upstairs that we could all go see in a moment? Kind of what your first conversations with Alex were about and what you looked at in the collections here?
I'm really glad you asked that, yes. Like I said, with the conversations that Alex and I had, it really enhanced, you know, my thinking. Sometimes when you're by yourself, you don't really have to, don't stop to articulate what, or take notes or whatever. But I knew for sure that I wanted the parfleches to be the focus. And but also I wanted to convey that, you know, that the language is still there. The descendants of those people that handled those, the language is still here. The land maybe have been designated to a reserve, but the land is still there. The outline of the river, the names that I used were significant to me as well. Like I said, with Akugatsin is one of them. I used my dad's name, Kohkitopi, Isitaki. What are some of the other ones? Now, oh, my granddaughter's name, Ipiu, Marley's. Where's Marley? Give a shout.
She's back there.
So her Blackfoot name is Ipiu because she's traveled a lot in her young years. So she's included. My grandson's name is Niitena. His name is there. But I wanted my response to not be an imposition visually, but also seeing through it again with that proximity. It's only when you come close then you see. And so it's like a whisper of, I'm not trying to say something to drown out, you know, the parfleches, because they need to be what the focus is.
Thank you so much for the enlightenment, and it touched me spiritually as well. I felt completely immersed in your art and your presentation. I was just wondering if you could maybe highlight some of the thoughts and feelings and the dreams, and these are things that you expressed that you thought and reflected on your ancestors as you were creating your art. Can you maybe mention some of those feelings and the dreams and things that you reflected on as you were creating the art?
I never feel a distance from them because, you know, they're my blood, I'm their blood. And so I know when our dad passed, one of the things that I sort of realized after kind of the grieving had eased a bit was that he's still with me, and I need to honor that by when I see something that he never would have seen. Say, for instance, seeing the Mississippi River for the first time. And so I feel, and I think I decided at that point that whenever I have an experience like that, I call him to mind. And it's not really like, you know, I say his name or whatever, but he's always there in my mind. And so I share that with him because I came from him. And so I feel the same way about ancestors that I've never even met. I think in a way, how to describe in a different way is that I was at this place. It's not, you know, the Sundance that you see, but it was known as the Piercer's Sundance that was imported to our community from the Dakotas. But a couple of family members were dancers. They had joined. And so we would go there and we would dance to support on the outside. And they sing pretty much the same song, same set of songs over and over. And the wind was blowing, of course, that day. And when I heard that song, it just occurred to me that this song has been sung, you know, how many years ago? And the sound doesn't really disappear. The wind maybe will carry it to somebody else's ears. So the sound has always existed. And so there's that continuity of, maybe not something physical, but in a sense it is, because I heard it, but it was carried by the wind. I don't know if that kind of makes sense, but.
I have a follow-up question to that. Is there any negative or anger that you feel by the, basically, the white man's impact?
I don't have a place for that.
Does that ever interfere or sort of jet through and cut through when you're creating, or is that even a part, or are you mostly just celebrating your ancestry?
Well, it's not like I go around dancing, making art, and celebrating my culture. You know, of course there are, you know, I did have an experience of, you know, loss, all of that. But I chose to accept it as part of who I am, but not to focus on it. And of course, it's not like I never get angry. Everybody gets angry every once in a while, but it's not what impels me, and it's not a part of my art.
Thank you.
This will be our last question.
How do the seasons and the life cycle on the land and the weather inform your art?
I didn't hear that.
How does the life cycle and the weather?
How does what?
How does the weather and the cycle of life affect your work?
I think just being aware and knowing that I'm a part of it. And a very small part of it, but it's a feeling of comfort to know that, you know, you're not this floating around in space, you know.